Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in hell, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid. Death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness lay, then bursting forth in glorious day. He rose again, and as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. In Christ alone I place my trust and faith.
Before we begin tonight, I just want to let everybody know that outside over here, be careful over by what used to be the school room. We have a broken window. I think all the glass is either in it or in the office area. But just be careful. Be aware of that. Don't run into that. Watch your children. Let's go ahead and open with a word of prayer. Brother Tim, would you open and ask God to bless our meeting tonight? Amen. Thank you very much. We're going to sing some choruses tonight. I hope you like choruses. I will bless the Lord. How many know this? Know this? Okay. Sing that again. I've been accused of not being able to walk and chew bubblegum at the same time. How many have that same problem? Just me? Okay. At any rate, you know, but as we sing these words, just thinking about it, you can sing them and not just sing them, but sing them and mean them. Amen. Take time to worship God tonight in song. Here, let's sing it again. A song, we're singing Lamb of Glory? Okay, Lamb of Glory. Okay, here we go.
Say
Almost make a Baptist want to raise his hands. Amen. Amen. Next song. In my life, Lord, be glorified. As families, just when you get around, maybe your family altar, or maybe you do it at the dinner time before you don't let the food go cold, but maybe just sing one of these choruses. Amen? That would be good. That would be good. How many know Shine, Jesus, Shine? This is a great chorus. Hopefully I can remember it.
Oh.
likeness, so our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Mirrored here, may our lives tell your story, shine on me, shine on me. Here we go. Shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze, set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow, flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth the word, Lord, and let my desire. How many know this song? Listen to it. Listen, let her play a little bit. Go ahead, play through a little bit. Sound familiar? Here, let's try it.
Joy of my desire, all consuming fire, Lord of glory, rose of Sharon, rare and sweet. You are now my peace, comforter and friend.
First time you've ever heard that. Just about everybody. Well, we need to sing it again then. I want to get this in your head, amen? And if you need the words, we can write them down for you, okay? All right, here we go.
Joy of my desire, all consuming fire. Friend,
you just about have it together.
Joy of my desire, all consuming fire, Lord of glory, rose of Sharon, rare and sweet. You are now my peace, comforter and
chorus. Isn't it a beautiful chorus? Do you enjoy singing the choruses? I enjoy singing the choruses as well. Thank you. Where are we at tonight? 1 Corinthians. Very good. What chapter? 7. Very good. Very good. Chapter 7. Not a very long message tonight. Could break all records? I doubt it. I got a little bit of an introduction here. Okay, but let's read 1 Corinthians chapter 7, and we'll read from verse 17 through verse 24. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, 17 through 24. But as God hath distributed to every man, as the Lord hath called every one, so let him walk. And so ordain I in all churches. So it's not just for this one particular church, but it's for everyone. That would include us. Is any man called being circumcised? Let him not be uncircumcised. Is any called in uncircumcision? Let him not be circumcised. Circumcision is nothing, and uncircumcision is nothing, but the keeping of the commandments of God. Let every man abide in the same calling wherein he was called. Art thou called being a servant? Care not for it. But if thou mayest be free, use it rather. For he that is called in the Lord, being a servant, is the Lord's freeman. Likewise also he that is called, being free, is Christ's servant. Ye are bought with a price. We need to remember that, folks. Ye are bought with a price. Cost the Lord Jesus Christ his life. Be not ye the servants of men. Brethren, let every man, wherein he is called, therein abide with God. Let's pray. God, we come to you again tonight, and we surrounded your word. Father, we thank you for your presence with us here today, through your Holy Spirit. God, I pray that as we have opened your word and now begin to listen to what you would have us to know, that our hearts will be opened. God, does us no good to come in here with a hard heart, closed off to any instruction. We need to be instructed from your words. We need to come in here and as if we're just sitting at your feet, looking and gazing up into your eyes and hearing you talk. Dear God, teach us, we pray. Have your will and way in our hearts and lives. In Jesus' name I ask, amen. We've been studying in the first book of 1 Corinthians, and we're in chapter 7 now. I think this is our eighth or ninth, something like that. And we've learned some things about the Church of Corinth. Can anybody tell me something about the Church of Corinth? What was the Church of Corinth? What kind of church was the Church of Corinth? It was a carnal church. It is a carnal church. And as we know, if you're carnal, you can be saved. You know, we're talking about carnal Christians here. Carnal Christians. We made a statement. The problem was they had a very casual view of sin. It was a very sinful city, a very progressive city. I've got my hand around that. A very progressive city. And they were sinful. They were very sinful, but they'd been saved out of that. And they'd had some questions. But we said that the problem was that the church had been invaded by the city rather than the city invading the church. Rather than the city invading the church. I think one of the most amazing, encouraging verses in the Bible is 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Praise God for that verse. It declares to us how much it is that Jesus transforms us by his power. Transforms the life of whomever trusts him. That's wonderful news that to know that there's been a total transformation on the inside. Amen? When you receive Jesus Christ, your personal Savior, old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Doesn't mean that you're perfect, but it does mean that you've got a new want to. You've got a new desire. You've got the Holy Spirit that lives and resides within you. All things truly have become new. That new life also has, guess what? The new life also has an impact on the outer life. On the outer life. See, what goes on on the inside eventually comes out. And the Bible talks about, you know, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. You know, we can tell who you are and what you're about. We get around you a little bit. We just sit and listen. We'll hear what you're talking about. Oh, I know what they're about. I know what drives them. Well, if you're a child of God, and you've received Jesus Christ, your Savior, then old things are passed away, and the things that you used to do are going to begin to change. They're going to begin to change. Old sinful habits and practices begin to be set aside. Those are set aside, and new practices and new habits become embraced. Several months ago, I preached and talked about developing new good habits. New good habits. The things we used to love to do, we no longer want to do. And that's the interesting thing. What you used to love to do, I don't want to do that anymore. I don't want to do that anymore. Praise God. I can go back through stages of my Christian life. And as I see myself grow spiritually, I don't want to do that anymore. I don't want to do that anymore. The Holy Spirit living in us helps us to walk through life in a new way. In a new way. We begin to do what? We begin to read the Bible with a new passion and with new understanding. Where you used to read it and go, I don't know what that's talking about. All of a sudden, it's like the blinders have fallen off and it becomes clear to you. I can see what he's saying. I understand what he's saying. The new Christian, it's amazing. Once they get this hold of this idea of praying, they want to pray about everything. Let's pray about that. Pray about everything. We start seeking out fellowship with other Christians. You need to watch. We need to watch, especially during this time and age in the country and in the world, with the thought of the pandemic. And I'm not saying, folks, don't take precautions and all that. Please understand what I'm saying. But don't lose sight of the main thing. We need to be fellowshipping with other Christians. If you feel like you need to do that with a mask and glove on, do it. But fellowship. Why? Well, you know, be real. We get out and we go to the store. We do the things we need to do. Why can't we spend time with other Christians? It'll only help to grow you in the Lord and grow you together. We need to start to show the love of Jesus for other people. We begin to treat our daily responsibilities and duties more seriously. Praise God for the total transformation that takes place from being a new creature in Christ. But that raises an important and practical question. And this is some of the questions that the church at Corinth had. Remember last week we talked about a couple things. One of the last things we ended up with was marriage. And we were talking about if someone was saved, the question was, I'm saved, but I'm married to a lost person. Should I divorce him? That's what they were talking about. And Paul said, stay married to him. Stay married to him. Because God can use you to do a work in that individual's life. God might use you to bring that person to a saving knowledge of his son, Jesus Christ. So he said the principle was you stay there. You stay married in there. So, but the important question is this. You're saved now, and you've had this total transformation on the inside. How much gets changed on the outside? How much gets changed on the outside? If everything on the inside is new, should we then completely get rid of every aspect of the old outside life and start over? Well, don't get ahead of me. Don't get ahead of me. Obviously, if it has to do with sin and it puts you in a bad situation where you cannot serve Christ, yeah, obviously you change that. But as I mentioned, we dealt with the question regarding marriage. And these you had these Christians at Corinth that were living in a very sinful culture. And folks, the world will impact you. The world will, it's like the moon in its tidal pool. It draws you. If you go to the things that were acceptable in God's church 50 years ago to now, we're liberal. You know, we're liberal. The world will change you. But the question was, how many of these things on the outside need to be changed? Need to be changed. As we continue to study in 1 Corinthians 7, we find that this was just not a principle in talking to the married people, but it was talking to those that got saved and how much on the outside changes. How much on the outside changes. It's a very important principle. So important that Paul repeats it three times. This principle, he repeats three times in this short passage. This short passage. Principle, first mentioned in verse 17. But God hath distributed to every man as the Lord hath called everyone, so let him walk. Here Paul lays down this rule in general. As God has distributed to everyone. That has to do with the outward mode of life. Now, let me make a statement. I am not Calvinist. But the longer I study, I think the more I become a sovereignist. God is sovereign. God has a plan for our life. God has placed us in a particular place. Why was I born in Stockton, California, to Loma and Sid Thomason? God designed it that way. It wasn't by accident. God didn't set this in motion and just let it go. He didn't just create the world and just let it go. Let's see what happens. He's a God of order. He's a God of purpose. And he had a purpose. He had a purpose. Point I want to make here is our state and our circumstances in this world are distributions of divine providence. I may get ahead of myself here a bit, but that's okay. When you get saved, we're in different situations. Different situations. Some are saved and perhaps you're in an industry that is not of God. Well, what do you do? Well, the Holy Spirit speaks to your heart and you know, I can't be in this industry. I've got to come out of this industry. But there are other situations where God has placed you in a situation and he's got a circle of friends and he's got a circle of people around you. You know, don't run off. Don't run off from an opportunity to allow Christ to shine in your life and be a witness and testimony to those around you. Don't run off. I can remember as a small child, and I mentioned to you this before, how that on Friday nights my family would have the poker parties. They had the green army blanket that would come out. I remember that. They'd have the cans of beer sitting there, and everybody would be having a good time. Then something happened. My mom and dad got saved. That was on a Tuesday night. Next Friday night, the poker party changed. It went to a password party. How many remember playing password? Anybody? Oh, you've missed a lifetime of fun. And it went to coffee. There were no more drinks there. They didn't change their friends. they kept an influence in the lives of their friends. And it's interesting. Some of them listened to the message of what God had done in their heart and life, and they received Christ as their Savior. They began to come to church. Others did not receive the message, but they did not leave their environment. Did not leave their environment. Now you need to allow that Holy Spirit to work in your heart and life, that you'll not be tempted to do some of those things. But you set the standard, what's going on. The fixes the bounds of men's habitation. In Acts chapter 17, verse 26, it says, "And hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitations." Psalms chapter 37, 23, the Bible says, "The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way." Ordered by the Lord. Psalm 75, 7 says, "But God is the judge. He putteth one down one and setteth up another." So as the Lord is called, let him walk. Whatever your circumstances, whatever your conditions are, when you're converted to Christianity, don't pull yourself out of that environment unless it's being you're coming out of it for the right reasons. Okay? God's put you in that. God's got you living in a certain place. Some you might say, "Deb, now Debbie, you've lived in your house where you're at how many years?" Yes. 30 years? Okay. Connie just moved. She'd been in her house half a century, I think. My dad lived in our house that I grew up in my high school years, 50 years. You just didn't happen there by coincidence. God is in control. And he's got set around you neighbors and people he wants you to be a witness and testimony to. Because they may never hear outside of you. May never hear. See, the rules of Christianity, living your life for God, they reach every condition we're in. Every condition. Something may happen at work, and you might want to just lose it. You might want to lose your top. You might want to explode. But if you allow the Holy Spirit to get a hold of your heart and life, you can use it as an opportunity to show the proper way to respond, and maybe an opportunity for to you to be a witness to somebody. They may come up to you and say, how could you contain yourself? How did you keep your temper? Well, let me tell you, I'm just like any other man. But when I received Christ as my Savior, I was transformed inside. Inside. I'm not perfect, but let me tell you about the perfect one. Perfect opportunity to be a witness and testimony. Staying the place we are at assumes that it's not a sinful environment. So I just want to make that sure that you understand. Don't ever leave yourself in a sinful environment that might cause temptation, something that is not pleasing to God, that's not of God's morality. And Paul now writes that this general principle applies to many other areas of life. Becoming a child of God does not mean automatically that God desires a person to completely change all their relationships or their occupations or their locations. Before you pick up and move, folks, prayerfully consider it to God. Before you change job, prayerfully consider it. God's got you in a place. We may think that we are in full control of our life, and certainly we do make decisions, and certainly we can get out of God's will, but we need to prayerfully consider where we're going to go. Why? Because God's got somebody, something he wants us to do for him. Your first opportunity for discipleship and service is right where you're at. Right where you're at. Paul is saying that God is the one who assigned these particular places in life to his people when they were called to faith. Read it. Read it. And he goes on and he says, "So ordain I in all the churches." Turn to Luke chapter 19, if you will. You guys all remember the story of Zacchaeus? Luke chapter 19. Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. He climbed up in a sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. And as the Lord was passing by, he looked up in the tree and he said, Zacchaeus, you come down, for I'm going to your house today. I'm going to your house today. That's a good song, isn't it? Zacchaeus. Chapter 19, verse 1. And Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was the chief among the publicans, and he was rich. This is a lost man here. And he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press, because he was little of stature. He was not a big man. Now, generally speaking, folks back in that day and age were much smaller than we are today. I'm amazed, though. I think we're putting way too many hormones in our foods, because I'm seeing girls, and I used to be 6'2", I'm shrinking, but that are taller than me. I walk by and I go, oh, that's a girl. And she's taller than me. But can you imagine? A wee little man. I mean, he could have been 4'6". Not very big. Not very tall. Verse 3, and he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press, because he was of little stature. And he ran before and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him, and said unto him, Zacchaeus, knew his name, make haste and come down, for today I must abide at thy house. Get an appointment. And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all murmured, saying that he was gone to be a guest with a man that is a sinner. Now that's what Jesus did. He'd sit down with a sinner. Why? He was talking to them about their need of him. Their need of him. But all these people knew Zacchaeus, and he was a rich guy, and he did not come by his money ethically. He was a thief. And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold. Something had happened. Look at the next verse. And Jesus said unto him, this day is salvation come to this house, for as much as he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Here you had this man, Zacchaeus. He was what? He was chief among the publicans, and he was rich. They didn't like him. He was not ethical. He'd steal their money, take their money. And yet salvation came to his house. And then he gave this testimony. Something happened. Something happened. He stayed where he was at, doing what he was doing, so that God could be honored and glorified. And Paul says, this is not just a rule for the church in Corinth, but for all the churches. For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. Romans 15:4. This was for us. We are to make application for us here. In verse 18, first of that circumcision, is any man called, saved while being circumcised? Let him not be uncircumcised. Is any man called, saved while being uncircumcised? Let him not be circumcised. Here we see Paul making the case that there were both Jews and Gentiles in the church. The Jew does not need to wish that he was a Gentile. The Gentile does not need to wish that he was a Jew. It matters not whether a man was a Jew or a Gentile. Doesn't matter whether he was circumcised or uncircumcised. Paul continued in verse 19, circumcision is nothing, and uncircumcision is nothing, but the keeping of the commandments of God. When you accepted Christ as your Savior, it did not matter to him if you were a Jew or a Gentile. It didn't matter to him. It didn't matter to him. A Jewish man might wish to be uncircumcised to perhaps help his standing with the Gentiles, or vice versa. It's not necessary. God had them, and he has you, he has us, right where he wants us. Right where he wants us. That said, there was teaching by some Jews that said it was necessary. It was necessary that you be circumcised in order to be a Christian. Paul dealt with this. Can anybody tell me what chapter or what book of the Bible that Paul dealt with this issue? Chapter, it talks about justification by faith. Book of Galatians. Book of Galatians, he dealt with that in depth. In depth. Second mention of the principle, verse 20, it says, therefore, let every man abide in the same calling, or the state that you're in, not California, Nevada, or anything like that, not that kind of state, but the condition you're in, wherein he was called. Second, the servitude, that servitude and freedom. It was common in that age of the world for many to be in a state of slavery. State of slavery. I remember we had a pastor, one of our former pastors, and he was teaching on working and working for the master. And he said, now, back in that day, they had slaves, so you really had to serve the master. But in this day and age, we're not slaves. And if you desire another job, you pray about it, and then you tell your master at the current time, I'm giving you my notice, and I'm moving on. We have that right. We have that right. But in this day and age, they had slaves. He says in verse 21, art thou called being a servant? Care not for it. Care not for it. As children of God, we're to be contented in the condition we're found in. In the situation we're found in. It doesn't mean that you can't pray about a new position. Huh, George? Maybe not something that gives you that 5 days a week that you want that's paying $50 an hour. Right? That would be nice. Amen? Sure. Sure. Paul's saying whether you are a slave or free, it makes no difference. Our relationship, our social situation, it's not our social situation that finds us. It's our relationship with God. The entire book of Philemon pivots around a runaway slave. How many know the name of the slave? Onesimus, right? Onesimus was a slave who Paul had led to Christ. And who was the master of Onesimus? It was Philemon. Philemon. And Paul was appealing to Philemon to let Onesimus serve with him in the gospel. Can you imagine that? That church was in Philemon's household, as I recall the story. But Paul was saying, allow Onesimus to serve with you, to serve with you. He goes on. Just make a note here that our comfort and our happiness doesn't depend on what or who we are in the world. It depends on what we are to Christ. What we are to Christ. Verse 22, for he that is called in the Lord, being a servant, is the Lord's free man. Likewise also, he that is called, being free, is Christ's servant. Ye are bought with a price. Be not ye the servants of men. Every Christian slave is the Lord's freeman. Freedom or slavery is not the issue. The issue is rather this, that the Lord owns each and every one of us. He is our master. He is our master. Whether you want to accept it or not, I think as Americans, probably, of all people, we may have more difficulty there than anybody else. We have been a privileged people. And I'll tell you, folks, unless God does a work and forgives our land, we may find out very quickly what it's like to be a slave. We're bought with a price. We're bought with a price. Our identity in Christ does not rest on our social situation. Jesus bought our spiritual freedom. That we're not to be the servants of sin. Child of God, remember, you've been freed out of the slavery of sin, by the way. Why do we keep going back to it? Why do we do it? I've never had the privilege to own pigs. And you've heard the saying, like, you know, it's like putting lipstick on a pig. You know, sometimes you'll see these pigs. We were out taking a drive the other day, and I that's the largest pig I've ever seen. It wasn't a pig. It was a cow, actually. Now, that's not as bad as some people. I remember years ago, we went to youth camp with a good friend of mine, and he said, Donnie, we're going to get up here about 5 in the morning and go down to the creek. It's in New Mexico. He says, because sometimes you see the bears come down to the creek, and you can see the bears. You want to come? I said, sure, let's go. So I went, a couple other guys went, and I remember my friend Brian was over there, and he's looking, and you could look downstream, and he saw a commotion, and he starts jumping up, and he goes, bears, and I went, Brian, those are dogs. So it's funny, because the remainder of the trip, we had like 3 vans, and we had these walkie-talkies, and so I'd be driving, and I'd grab that walkie-talkie, hey, Brian. He said, yeah. I said, don't look now, but over on your left, some giraffes. Just, and there were cows. But we just had a good time. Third, he sums up his advice in verse 24. He says, brethren, let every man wherein he's called, therein abide with God. For the third time, Paul points out that the believer should stay in a situation. We're quick to leave. We're quick to run off. I'll tell you what, when people get saved, they genuinely get saved, and God's done a work in their heart and life. I can remember years ago, the Brother Baskins, the Brother Ken Walkers, who come through the church on behalf of Pacific Coast Baptist Bible College, and they talk about being a missionary and these other things. And you know, you just desire to pick up and go to Bible College. Why? You want to serve the Lord. That's a good desire. But not everyone is called. And not all the time should we leave our present situation that God has us in. We need to prayerfully consider that. Prayerfully consider that. The special presence and favor of God are not limited to any outward condition or performance of man. It is God that gives us all we are and we do. Colossians chapter 3:11 says, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond or free, but Christ is all and in all. God is not bound by our circumstances. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for just a few minutes in your word tonight. Lord, I ask that you have met with us. Father, I pray that we have worshiped you in this hour. But God, what better way to worship you than to bow ourselves before you, confess our sin, allow you to have your will and way in our life. God, we're not perfect. We fall every day. But God, through you, we can stand again and get up and walk in your paths of righteousness. Lord, I pray that you'll do a work in the hearts and lives of everyone here tonight. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you'll stand together.